This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Max Milo Editions present The Lost Art of Perfume by Septimus Piesse. He who ruled scent ruled the hearts of men. Patrick Süskind, Perfume. The manufacturing secrets of Jean-Baptiste Grenouille, the hero of Süskind's novel, have been forgotten. Or nearly forgotten. Master perfumer Septimus Piesse, 1820-1882, was one of the last to learn about musical alchemy and the intimate history of fragrances. There is, so to speak, an octave of odors, like an octave of notes. Certain perfumes blend together like the sounds of an instrument. We present here the essentials of this 1857 classic, which also traces the history of perfumes among the Romans, Chinese, and Egyptians. The afterword includes a short treatise on the political role of flowers. Septimus Piesse was an illustrious master perfumer and expert chemist of the 19th century, one of the last to follow artisanal methods. His book, published in 1857, remains a reference. He is the creator of the odophone, a sound perfume correspondence table. Notes and illustrations are available on electronic and paper editions of the book. Part 1: Perfumery Through the Centuries. The creator's hand has poured all the treasures of his wealth onto flowers. After placing them on graceful, delicate stems, he has painted them with the most vivid, varied, and harmonious colors and impregnated them with the most exquisite scents. The flower occupies an important place in nature's designs. In the middle of the corolla are placed the reproductive organs destined to perpetuate the species after the death of the individuals who have borne them. So, from the cradle, man has learned to respect such magnificent productions, and if he has sometimes allowed himself to put a reckless hand on them, it has undoubtedly only been to pay homage to the creator of what he considered to be the symbol of perfection. In recognition of God's sovereign dominion over his creatures, man has sought to extract the sweet perfumes they contain from flowers, and has taken from various plants the intoxicating resins and balms, some of which are still burned in our temples. The first traces of the perfumer's art can be found in the religious ceremonies of the earliest peoples. Among the nations of antiquity, an offering of perfumes was regarded as a token of the deepest and most respectful veneration. Pliny places the origin of perfumery in those beautiful lands of the Orient, where plant riches are found together, as in a privileged country which, being the first to receive the sun's rays, seems to exhaust all its invigorating virtues. His opinion is confirmed by the Holy Scriptures. The Bible's frequent references to perfumes and aromatics prove that, from very early on, they were widely consumed by peoples whose soil produced aloes, cinnamon, sandalwood, camphor, nutmeg, and cloves. The incense tree, from which the Sabines had the holy privilege of collecting the gum resin, the balsam or balsam tree, the sad nyctanthus, which spreads its rich perfumes at dusk, the nilica, in whose flowers the bees, it is said, fall asleep to the sound of their own buzzing. All these plants and a host of others no less fragrant belong to the East, and for centuries remained unknown to the rest of the world. Chapter 1. Jewish Perfumes. That the ancients attached an idea not only of personal respect, but also of religious homage to an offering of incense, is proved by the example of the Magi who, after prostrating themselves on their knees to adore the newborn Jesus and having recognized his divinity, offered him gold, myrrh, and incense. It doesn't seem that the Jews made much use of perfumes for their personal hygiene, as the strict prescriptions of the law of Moses against those who used perfumes reserved for the sanctuary may have deterred them from doing so. It is certain, however, that in addition to the perfumes burnt in the temple, the Jews had others which they poured over the dead. We see this in the example of Joseph of Arimathea, who anointed the body of Jesus before burying him, and in Jesus' reply to Judas, who reproached Mary for using a preparation borrowed from banquets as an unnecessary luxury. "She is preparing my burial." We find in St. John, it was their custom to sprinkle aromatic substances on the dead, especially myrrh and aloes, which came from Arabia. This ceremony was expressed in ancient Greek by a verb meaning to embalm or to bury. It was performed by neighbors and relatives. The Jews used to anoint themselves with perfumes before meals. However, it seems certain that they made little progress in the art of perfuming, and were content to use aromatics as nature offered them, or at most dissolved in suitable vehicles. The early Christians imitated the Jews and adopted the use of incense in liturgical ceremonies. Saint Ephrem, father of the Syrian church, wrote in his will that no perfume should be burned or scattered on his coffin, but rather that the aromatics should be given to the sanctuary. Perfumes were used in the service of the church not only in the form of incense, but also mixed with oil and wax for the lamps and candles that were to burn in the Lord's house. Chapter 2. Chinese perfumes. The Chinese, whose sensualism is so refined, make great use of perfumes, to which they give a large place in their worship, their domestic uses and their pleasures. They burn fragrant woods and resins before their altars and mix them with food. It is above all aphrodisiacs that are sought after, and it is said that they know how to prepare certain scented balls made of amber, musk and hemp flowers mixed with opium and other more energetic substances. Heated for a while and rolled in the hand, they throw the small-footed beauties who populate the celestial empire into a voluptuous spasm. Chapter 3. Perfumes in the Orient. Zoroaster's followers prayed before altars where the sacred fire shone, and five times a day the priests put wood and odors on them. In the East, it is now considered a proof of friendship and an act of hospitality to sprinkle visitors with rose oil or to perfume them with aloe wood at the end of each visit. In an excellent work that paints a vivid picture of Eastern domestic life, we find several passages on the use of perfumes. Such is the story of the barber's younger brother, who, finding himself lured into the palace of the Grand Vizier's wife to become her plaything and amusement, saw himself painted like a woman, shaved and then perfumed with aloe wood and rosewater. Chapter 4. Scythian perfumes. Herodotus tells us that Scythian women used to grind cypress wood, cedar and frankincense on a stone. They then poured in a certain amount of water until the mixture took on the consistency of a paste that was used to coat the face and limbs. This composition first gave off a pleasant smell. Then when it was removed the next day, it made the skin soft and radiant. Chapter 5. Perfumes in Egypt. Egyptian ladies often carried small sachets of scented gum resins, as is still the custom among the Chinese. Indeed, we all know that the dead among the Egyptians were wrapped in aromatics, which have preserved their mummies down to the present day. Chapter 6. Greek perfumes. Greek mythology attributed the invention and use of perfumes to the immortals, and, according to the fable, men only learned of them through the indiscretion of Enon, one of Venus' nymphs. When the gods of Olympus favored a mortal with their visit, they left behind them a scent of ambrosia, an unequivocal sign of their divine nature. The custom of anointing the bodies of the dead with perfumes was not peculiar to the Jews. All the peoples of antiquity seem to have practiced the same ceremonial in this respect. Thus we find in Homer that Venus herself watched over the remains of Hector night and day, pouring over him a precious balm. The Greeks, moreover, were very fond of perfumes and had made remarkable progress in the art of the perfumer. In this respect, they went so far as to enclose their clothes in scented chests, as we learn from Homer's account of Ulysses, and according to Athenaeus, they had cassolets that spread sweet smells in the air while they were at table. Like the Romans, they had the custom of crowning themselves with roses at feasts, and the Athenians' most esteemed wines were perfumed with violets, roses, and various aromatics. That of Byblos in Phoenicia was especially remarkable in this respect. The luxury of perfumes was even taken so far that a law passed by the wise Solon forbade Athenians from using them. Among the Lacedaemonians, this luxury was always outlawed, and perfumers were banished from the city as people who lost oil, for the same reason that all those who dyed wool were rejected, because they destroyed its whiteness. Despite the prohibitions of Solon and Lycurgus, the taste for perfumes soon became widespread in Greece, and was pushed to a degree of refinement that had never been reached before and has never been surpassed since. Although the Orient supplied the Athenians with the most highly prized gums and essences, they considerably expanded the list of fragrant plants already in use. Apollonius, a disciple of Herophilus, wrote a treatise on perfumes. The best iris, he says, comes from Ellis and Sizicus. The best rose essence is made in Pharsales, Naples and Capua. Crocus essence is superior in Soli, Cilicia and Rhodes. Essence of spikenard from Tanius, vine leaf extract from Cyprus and Adramitium, marjoram oil and apple extract from Cos, palm oil from Cyprinus, gladiolus from Egypt, the best afterwards from Cyprus and Phoenicia, especially Sidon. The perfume known as Panathenaicum is made in Athens. In Egypt, the perfumes known as Metopian and Mendesian are prepared with superiority. However, the quality of each perfume is due to the substances and operations rather than to the country itself. The boxes in which the ointments were kept were usually made of alabaster, elegantly adorned, and would form an important item in the jeweler's brief. They were called alabastra. They were also onyx vases. These preparations were preserved in oil and colored red, with cinnabar or sorrel, Pliny. But if we are to believe a passage in Alexis Colon, this prodigality itself was far surpassed. For to perfume himself, he did not dip his fingers in alabaster, the ordinary custom of bygone times, but released four doves fully impregnated with essences, not of a single species. Each carrying a particular perfume different from the others, they hovered over us, and with their damp wings rained their fragrances on our dresses and clothes. I too, don't be too jealous, gentlemen, was doused with essence of violets. The room in which a meal took place was always perfumed, either by burning incense or by scattering eau de ceinture on the furniture. An unnecessary precaution, considering the profusion with which the guests themselves covered themselves in essences. Each part of the body had its own particular fragrance. Mint was recommended for the arms, palm oil for the cheeks and chest. An ointment made from marjoram was applied to the eyebrows and hair. Essence of ground ivy was used for the knees and neck. Quince provided a useful essence for lethargy and dyspepsia. The fragrance of grape leaves kept the mind lucid and that of white violets was favorable to digestion. As part of the athletic exercises at the Olympic Games, wrestlers and pancratiasts, wrestlers who fought in pancratae, used to oil their limbs to make them more supple. Perfumes from Athens enjoyed a great reputation, as we can see from a curious fragment handed down by Athenaeus. This passage shows us where the most esteemed of each kind was obtained in his time. A cook from Elis, a cauldron from Argos, wine from Pliant, tapestries from Corinth, fish from Sisiwan, cheese from Sicily, perfumes from Athens, and needles from Boeotia. Just like the Romans, who esteemed above all the roses of Paestum. In Greece, perfumers' stores were open to all. They served as meeting places, where the interests of the state were discussed, fashions decreed, scandalous stories told. And in Athens it was said, let's go to the perfume shop, as we say, let's go to the cafe. The fashion for perfuming the head at banquets is said to have stemmed from the idea that the stimulating effects of wine would be better tolerated with a damp head, just as a patient consumed by a burning fever feels relieved by the application of a wet compress. Aristotle, better guided by his habit of observation, made a different and truer argument, attributing the large number of men with grey hair to the drying nature of the ingredients of which ointments were composed, and he was not alone in this opinion. It is not without intention that Sophocles depicts Venus, the goddess of pleasure, perfumed and looking at herself in a mirror, and that he shows Minerva, the goddess of reason and chastity, softening her limbs with oil before engaging in gymnastic exercises. Chrysippus sought in the etymology of the word a reason to reject the thing. But this far-fetched argument only served to expose him to the mockery of an ancient joker, who said in this connection that, without physicists, there would be nothing so silly in the world as grammarians. Socrates prescribed all perfumes, slaves and freemen, he said, when perfumed, smell the same. This criticism made little impression on his pupil Aeschines, who became a perfumer, incurred debts, and tried to borrow money against the value of his stock. Alexander was more sensitive to the observations of his preceptor Leonidas, who reproached him for lavishing incense in sacrifices. It will be time, his master told him, to show yourself as generous when you have conquered the countries that produce incense. The king remembered the lesson, and when he had conquered Arabia, he sent his old preceptor a considerable supply of frankincense and myrrh. Chapter 7. Roman Perfumes. From Greece, perfumes quickly found their way to Rome, and although the sale of perfumes was at first strictly forbidden, their use became more extravagant every day. To get an idea of this, All you have to do is read the Latin poets, especially the comic ones. The Romans, who had conquered Egypt, India and Arabia, obtained huge quantities of perfumes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.